thanks all for coming. I'm glad you found the way to this room, even though it's a little bit remote. My name is Tia Grumpf. I'm an assistant prof at Purdue University, and I would like to talk to you about some work we did on at the intersection of databases and programming languages. So the title of my talk is how types can turn a SQL interpreter into a SQL compiler, and that's basically what I would like to show you over the next 30 minutes. So before we dive in, just a little refresher, how do database query engines work, right? So we start with something that looks like a SQL statement or a statement in some other relational query language. And what the SQL engine does is it will transform this into something that's called a logical plan, right? And this logical plan essentially corresponds to operations in relational algebra. So you have things like scans and filters, projections, joins, and these kind of things, right? And once we figured out the logical structure of the query that is supposed to be executed, then the database engine will apply a number of optimizations, right? So you can reorder joins, you can push predicates closer to the data sources, and so on. And the next step is going to be the physical plan. So here we have more details, right? So we no longer only know that, well, this is a join that is going to be executed, but we know that this is to be a hash join or a sort merge join or which individual implementation of a given operator. And then what usually happens in most existing databases is that there's kind of an interpreter, right, that iterates over this query plan. And for every tuple in the result, we will call an iterator method, right? So first we need to open the iterator, and then for every new record that we want to get out of the query, we call next, right? And once we're done, we call close. So for every record that we want to get out of the query, there's a function call overhead, and sort of there's a uniform API for all of these query operators that conform to this iterator model normally. So if we're looking at this from a kind of compiler perspective, then well, that really looks like a traditional compiler, right? So we have a bunch of intermediate languages, we have a bunch of transformation optimizations, and so on. But the key difference is that most database engines will stop at the point where we have the physical query plans, right? So there's no code generation phase. And you could imagine that there's quite a bit of overhead, right, involved in this last interpretation step. So the idea, of course, is, well, we might want to replace this with actually a generation step that emits native code. But then also the question is, well, what's the right way to do this, right? And in particular, I mean, we could sort of look at traditional compiler textbooks and see, well, there's all the kinds of things we need to do. We need to do instruction scheduling and register allocation and so on. Or maybe we can encapsulate this by using a framework such as LLVM. But in any case, it gets very messy and very low level, right? And sort of the database engineers really have to become compiler engineers to make the step to native code generation. So what I want to show you in this talk is that, well, it doesn't have to be this way. There's actually very nice high-level approaches of just implementing query interpreters in high-level languages and then using the type system to turn those things into high-performance query compilers. And if that sounds too good to be true, then, well, you know, don't take my word, but watch what I have to show you. Right? So the first question is how fast are databases, right? And can we somehow quantify this interpretive overhead and see, okay, what is the performance gain we could potentially achieve, right? And in order to do this, I have prepared a little demo and a benchmark, and it's just a very simple query. So I've downloaded a data file from the Google Books Ngram viewer, right? So Google Books allows you to download files with statistics, which words occur how many times in the Google Books database, right? And this is something like a 2 gigabyte file, so it's not really what you would call big data or anything, but it's still sizable to process on a small laptop like the one I have here. And we're just going to use a standard database system, in this case MySQL. And so what I did before the talk was I just loaded this data file into a MySQL database, right? And what you can see is that already took almost 5 minutes, right? Just loading the data. And you can argue, well, okay, maybe that's not super time critical and it's not something that database systems optimize for. But it's still sort of quite significant amount of time. And now let's actually run a query in MySQL and see how long that takes, right? So we're iterating over a 2 GB file and we're just looking for keywords in one of the rows. Right? So does anybody of you have an idea how long that would take?
Sorry, you're looking for unigrams here? Just a single word?
Yeah, I'm just, sort of, it's a table and I'm just looking for keywords in one of the columns.
And the word you're looking for is the word attributes?
Yes.
Yep, got it.
How long is it going to take? What do you think?
Probably the same 5 minutes.
The same 5 minutes?
Well, maybe not. It could be a hash table. It depends on what indices we're building.
No indices. So just plain table scale. Okay, so 5 minutes. Any other takers?
I guess there's only one column.
2.5 minutes.
2.5 minutes? 30 seconds? Anybody want to say 5 seconds? Here's the statement. So I just did MySQL import and gave it the file. So nothing special, no indexes. Okay, so let's try, right? So I think everybody is careful. Oh, I didn't select the database, so use gbooks. Okay, so more than 5 seconds at least, right? And well, we can watch and sort of wait for the result. And while we're waiting, we can actually think about, well, what is really going on here, right? And so maybe loading this into a database and doing this query might not be the fastest way, right? So as a potential alternative, I could go ahead and just write a little program in Scala that does the same thing, right? And for something simple, like just doing a scan and a filter, this is actually quite doable, right? So here's a little piece of Scala code that does the same thing, right? And it's sort of reasonably low level, so I'm opening a scanner, right, and then I'm iterating over the scanner while there is more input. I'm reading the first column, see if that phrase is the same as string attributes, and if yes, then I'm printing out the result. So let's see if MySQL is still running. Right, so in a separate shell, let's just run the Scala code, see how long that takes. Already get some results because we are doing this on the fly and not accumulating all the data. 14 seconds. And let's see if MySQL is still running. MySQL is done, right? So 1 minute and 4 seconds. Right? So you can see there's quite a bit of difference whether we're running a database engine or whether we're just writing a little script that does that basically just implements the query directly. Okay.
So is the reason for 1 minute instead of five only that you're only looking at the fifth of the database, which is unigrams? So there's probably 1 gram through 5 grams in the database?
No, it's only 1 gram. It's one single file that gets loaded into one single table, and we're just doing one single scan over this table.
Okay. So scanning was faster, and that's because reading is faster than writing, and because it doesn't have to compare the whole string, it can give up after the first character doesn't match or something.
Not sure I understand, but so the main difference is that here with this piece of Scala code, we are really telling it directly, here are the operations you need to do, right? And for the database systems, we're giving it a query plan, and for every tuple in the input table, it needs to have function calls, it needs to say, okay, give me the next one, then evaluate the predicate, and even that is like an interpretive computation, right? So there's an expression tree, and you need to implement that and execute the loaded code, right? So at every stage, there is a lot of overhead involved in these computations. Okay, so the Scala code took 14 seconds or something, right? So the question is, well, is that the maximum we can achieve? And of course, we can get a little bit better by writing this code not in Scala, but actually writing it in C. Right? So in C, we don't have any memory management overhead. There's no just-in-time compilation, and so on. Right? So let's, and you can see that, okay, well, this is still sort of gets a little bit harder to read, but it's still sort of pretty reasonable code, right, that you could expect you could write yourself, right, for a simple query like this. So let's run this piece of C code. Any ideas how long that will take? 5 seconds. Okay, let's try. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Get the same result. Yeah, also 14 seconds, right? So intuitively, we would think, well, maybe just writing it in C, that buys us something. But it turns out that just-in-time compilation actually works really, really well, and we don't do any memory allocation, so there's no garbage collection overhead. So there's virtually no difference between sort of a naive Scala implementation and a naive C implementation. Right. But sort of if we think a little bit more about this, then sort of on the C level, we have a few more things we can play that are not so easy when we're running on a JVM. Right? So one particular thing is that we can actually use memory mapped I/O, right? So we don't have to go through the operating system file API to load a file, then copy the data from an OS buffer, and then do the evaluation, right? But we can just memory map the file into memory, and then treat it as an array, right? And you can see that, okay, this piece of code already looks quite a bit more involved, right? And when we run this one, so this is hand2.c, then I think we should see something below 5 seconds, right? So this is just a little more than 2 seconds. Right? So you can see, okay, well, here's the range of performance you get, right? So a general purpose database system that does not generate native code, that will take like about a minute, and sort of the optimized C code for exactly the same query takes just 2 seconds. So what can we do about this, right? So what we would like to have is actually, just generate exactly this C code from a SQL query. And I'm going to show you how we can do that. And in order to do so, we are going to consider a slightly different and much smaller data set. So I just have a little table of like 15 talks and scheduled times from another conference. And we're going to gradually build up a little SQL engine for this. And so here I have a file with a bunch of different steps. And on the right, I can show you the output of each of those steps, right? So in the beginning, we have nothing, right? So and as the first step that we can look at, this is, again, just a handwritten implementation of a particular query in Scala, right? So if you look at the code, then basically we iterate over the table and we're looking for all the talks that happen at 9 a.m., right? And we want to print out the room and the title. And what I'm doing here is I'm running SBT in the background, so whenever I change the file and hit save, then it will recompile and rerun the output on the right. Okay? So this is what we're starting with, and this is the sort of reasonably fast code we want to execute, and we're just going to add abstractions on top of this until we have a full query engine, right? So the next thing we can do is we want to introduce an abstraction over the data schema and over a record type, right? So here we have to say, okay, give me the next field, and we're dependent on the order of things. So what we would like to have is this record class, which has a list of fields and the schema, which is a list of field names. And then with this apply method, it supports lookup of field data by name, right? So if we have a record, we can say, get me the field with a given name. And you can see how this works. So we're still iterating over the scanner, which gives us access to the data file. But now for every line in the file, we're creating a new record object, right? So that's the line here. And then we can say, okay, if the time field in a record is 9 a.m., then we want to print out the room field and the title field. So this is already considerably more general than what we had before, right? And you could imagine that you could actually implement something that has a little more complexity using this API. So the next thing we would like to abstract over is this while loop here. Right? So we would like to encapsulate all the file handling in a method that we call process CSV. And what we're doing inside process CSV is precisely what we did before. So we're creating a scanner, we're iterating over the scanner, and for each line in the file, we are creating a new record object. But instead of having this intertwined with the actual query logic, this is now a separate abstraction, right? So we can reuse this to implement many different kinds of queries. Right? And each individual query now just looks like this. So we say process CSV, we give it a file name, and then we have a callback here, right? So in this callback, we have to specify what should happen to each record that we are reading from the file. And precisely what we're doing is just what we did before, right? So we're comparing the time field to a constant, and if that check succeeds, then we're printing out the room and the title of the talk, okay? So now we already have disentangled much of the internal plumbing from the actual query logic, right? So this is already quite nice. And the infrastructure we have with this process CSV abstraction and this callback here allows us to build a SQL interpreter on top of this in a very straightforward way. Right? So basically what we need to do is we need to implement a little DSL that captures the relational algebra operators. Right? So we do this in Scala by having an abstract base class operator, and then we have subclasses for scans, for printing, for projections, filters, joins, groups, and so on. And we also need auxiliary expression classes for predicates and for references and so on. And all of these things are case classes because in Scala we want to be able to perform pattern matching on these things. Okay, so let's look how that would work. Right? So we have, and we need, of course, a parser. Right? So the details of that aren't very important, but basically we can use parser combinators or any other kind of technique to go from a textual SQL statement to a tree of operators. And then what we do is we implement a method that is called execop here, which implements the semantics of query operators, right? So this is really the query interpreter, right? So we get an operator op as parameter, and we still have a callback, right? So this is what we want to do with each record that we're reading. And then we match on what kind of operator we have, right? So if it's a scan operator, then we're just calling the process CSV method that we implemented before, right? With the given file name. And if it's a print operator, then we call exec op on the parent operator, right? So this is the data source. And in the callback for each record, we're just printing out all the fields. So now we can load data from a file, and we can print out results to the console. So that already gets us started essentially doing something like cat, right? Read data and print out the same thing again. So on the right, you can see that we're sort of just copying the file essentially. So now, of course, we would like to implement more interesting operators. And essentially, we can scale this up by just modifying this execop implementation, right? So the next thing we might want to look at are projections, right? So projections take a record and pass on a new record to the consumer that has some of the fields renamed potentially and some of the fields removed. And we can just do it like this, right? So again, we call exec op on the parent operator, our data source. And then in the callback, we're producing a new record with fields renamed and potentially some of them removed. The next thing we might want to implement is filters. So filter is something that will evaluate an expression based on a given record, and if that expression evaluates to true, then it will forward the record, otherwise it will just discard the record. So this is when we're looking for talks at 9 a.m., then this is what we want to use. Right? And again, implementation is straightforward. So just inside the callback, we have to call this eval prep method. And eval prep is the implementation is shown here. So right now, we're only considering equalities. And we're considering equalities between references. And the reference might either be a reference to a field in a record, or it might be a constant. So this is how we compare to a literal like 9 a.m. Good. So once we have that, we can basically evaluate the same query that we have written by hand in the beginning, right? And we'll just try this out, and yeah, we should get the same result as we had initially. And here we're printing the operator tree just for reference. So far so good. So in very little code and with very little effort, we have implemented a SQL interpreter, right? So essentially, this is almost a fully functional database system, right? So it does not do any transactions or something, but it can load data, it can evaluate queries, and it will produce a result, right? And when I run this, and if we do some timing, then it will be as slow as MySQL, right? So if we do the benchmark on the Google Books data set again, then this will again take about a minute. So now what we're going to do is we're turning this query interpreter into a query compiler, right? So this is what we set out to do, and this was the whole motivation. And the way we're doing this is we're going to use a framework which is called LMS, which we developed previously in Scala. And the idea is that we're using the type system generate code at runtime, right? So you can see here, I'm creating this LMS driver object. And this driver object has a method which is called snippet. And the arguments and result types are rep of int and rep of unit. And this rep of t is a special marker type that will denote expressions for which we're generating code, okay? So when we just run this test case here, then what we should get on the right is something like this, right? So we can take a look at the snippet that we implemented here, right? So we have, we're taking x, which is a rep of int as argument, and then we're testing whether x is less than 4, and if yes, we want to print hello, and if no, we want to print world. And since x is a rep of int type, this conditional will actually be a rep of boolean, right? So all the operators are overloaded here, and these rep types kind of propagate. So what will happen is that also this if then else will be rewritten as a method called in Scala. And all these overloaded operators are implemented in such a way that they will generate code which represents the operation, right? So on the right, what we get for this snippet is a piece of code that exactly corresponds to what we have on the left. But now the crucial bit is that even though sort of all these rep types will trigger code generation, any other bit of computation that I interleave with the code generation, but which does not involve rep types, will just be executed at code generation time. Right? So in essence, I can combine things that are executed now and things that are executed later as part of the code we're generating. Right? And this is sort of the key thing that will allow us to turn this interpreter into a compiler, that we can resolve all the interpretation overhead while we're generating the code. And if we think about, okay, these rep types, they designate all the things that are dynamic or data dependent, then that will guide us in sort of how to structure this code generation process. And the particular thing we need to think about is, okay, what is the dynamic data that is loaded from the data source, and what are the objects that only depend on the structure of the query or on the data schema? And in particular, we can start doing this by looking at our record abstraction, right? So here we've put essentially the entire query engine into this LMS driver object, right? So this means we can interleave things that are executed now and things for which we're generating code. And if we look at the implementation of records, then there's already a clear separation into execution stages, right? So the schema is something that's available statically, right? So this is part of the database and part of the query that we're running, right? Versus the actual field data, that is something that only becomes available once we've loaded the data file, right? So the way to change the types here is that schema stays a vector of string, just like it was before. But we change the type of the fields from vector of string to vector of rep of string. And this type signature is actually quite interesting because we could also consider that this could be a rep of vector of string. But if we do it like this, then what will actually happen is that the length of the vector is also something that's known statically. Right? And this is exactly what we want, right? Because we know the shape of these records. Right? The only thing that is dynamic is the actual data. And sort of once we've made this decision, essentially we just need to go through and fix the type errors, right? And figure out, okay, where else do we need to put these rep types in key places? And of course, when we do a by name lookup, then the result of that will also be a rep of string and no longer just a string, right? Because we're returning a dynamic field of the record. Process CSV stays the same, right? So we don't need to do anything here because everything is encapsulated in this record abstraction, right? And so one little change we need to do is the scanner also needs to become an object that will return dynamic data. So this is kind of hidden in the scanner abstraction. And then eval ref and eval prep, so those methods obviously will need to return dynamic data, right? Because they are dependent on the values that we're working with. And execop again, basically does not need to change at all, right? So this is something that is really only dependent on the structure of the query operators, right? So the whole dispatch logic and everything that that is related to that can just exactly stay the same, right? No modifications are necessary. And that's basically all we had to do here, right? So we're sort of relying on the fact that we have overloaded most primitive operations like integer plus and minus and Boolean comparison and if then else, right? And sort of the high level structure of the query engine is more or less unchanged. And sort of just to demonstrate that this actually works, right, when I enable this test, then now you can see that for the given query that we started with, right? So select time, room, and title from talk CSV, where time is 9 a.m. We're now generating this snippet of Scala code, okay? And if you compare that to the one we started with, right? So we have that here, then you can see that, well, this is really, this was the different data set. So let me just pull up the right one again, right? So the query we started with is this one. Right. And you can see that, well, this is really exactly the same, right? So modulo renaming of variables, it's exactly the same code that we're generating as the one that we started with, right? And if we execute this on the Google Books data set, then it will also run in 10 seconds. And if we tweak things slightly so that we're generating C code, then we can also get the runtime down to 2 seconds again. How do we handle loops? Yes, so we also have overloaded an overloaded constructor for while loops. Right? So when either the loop condition or the body has type rep of t, then we will generate a while loop in the code that we're emitting. So very similar to the if then else. I'm sorry?
Do you execute that once or do you iterate?
Well, it depends sort of, it depends when the loop is executed, right? So if we have a loop with a normal Boolean condition, then this is something that will be unrolled at code generation time, right? And if the condition of the loop is a wrap of Boolean, then that means that we'll be generating a loop. And that will be executed as many times as necessary, right? So if we're iterating over the number of records in a database, then we will execute this the loop body once for every record of this. Okay? Good. So any questions at this point?
Have you got to talk about query optimization?
I'm not going to talk about query optimization much, but sort of because we're assuming that sort of when we go back to the picture in the slides, then sort of the high level optimizations, they have already been done, right? At that point where we look at something like a physical plan, then that has already been optimized sort of in a way that database systems normally work, right? So we've done things like join reorderings and sort of picking whether something is a hash join or a sort merge join and so on. One thing that we...
But you would need some additional kinds of nodes in the tree beyond the ones that you've already defined about the handle, say a hash.
Yeah, we could, right? So this, I mean, there's sort of the question of interaction with the query optimizer, right? But we can basically take any existing query optimizer and just say, okay, now we're going to accelerate this by generating code for each of the operators instead of interpreting them at runtime, right? And this is something we actually did. Any more questions at this point? Yes?
Yeah, I do have one. So if you were running directly in the Scala interpreter, then would Scala give you any useful optimizations on its own, thanks to, say, tuple optimization in the JVM, that will not be transferred to the generated code? In other words, are you losing something by generating code that looks a lot like your Scala source code, as opposed to what actually gets executed in Scala?
Are we losing anything? Well, I mean, there are concerns.
Scala has its own optimizations. Your generated code doesn't have it.
Well, we're still generating Scala code or C code, right? So we are reusing like a downstream compiler that will do optimizations of
Scala.
Well,
if you generate Scala code, I guess it's okay.
Yeah. I mean, sort of the kind of shape of code you generate also matters, right? So that you want to be, you don't want to generate code that is too large, right? So the JIT compiler won't actually compile it, right? Or these kind of things, right? Or you, even when you're generating C code, you have to be sort of a bit careful about iCache behavior and these things, right? Anyway, so one thing I want to mention is that, okay, well, this is not really something we invented, but sort of what we're relying on is really a core principle that has its roots in work coming from Japan and Russia that has been done in the 1970s. And what we do is also known as the first Futamura projection, right? So I don't know if anybody has ever heard about this. But it's basically a generic principle how to turn interpreters into compilers, right? And the key idea is that what you do is when you have an interpreter, which sort of in general is a program that takes two inputs, a source program and then the input data, that if you have a capability of specializing this program with respect to the given source program, then essentially what you're getting out of this is a compiled version of the program that is to be interpreted. And in sort of the history of partial evaluation, sort of this specialization process, that always has been the difficult part, right? Because sort of you assume that you have a partial evaluator that is so powerful that it can work for any kind of interpreter and actually produce the correct specialization, right? And that has turned out to be quite hard in practice. So in one sense, what we are doing is we are removing a lot of the automatic assumption here and just saying, okay, look, we're providing a programming model that allows you to write the specialized interpreter directly, right? And it's not more complicated than writing a normal interpreter. But we're still getting the same benefit of this specialization and Futamura projection idea. And I just want to wrap up with yeah, trying to answer the question, well, does it scale? Right? So obviously what I showed you is just a very small toy interpreter. But we actually did a lot more work, and a couple of years ago we got a best paper award at DLDB, and more recently we looked at Apache Spark and built an accelerator backend for Spark and Spark SQL that gets us very good speed up across a whole range of standard database benchmarks, right? So this is showing the standard TPCH benchmark, right? And it has 22 different queries, and for all of these queries we get something like a 10x or more speed up over the plain Spark implementation, and also compared to traditional database systems like Postgres. And we are basically on par with the best compiled database engines that use LLVM underneath and have a much more complicated internal implementation. Okay. And yeah, we can also play with the input format, do some optimizations there. We can do parallelism, optimize things for NUMA-aware architectures, and so on. And if you want to know more about this, then there's a paper we published at ICFP 2 years ago, which basically describes the implementation I showed here, plus a few additional details on generating specialized data structures and these kind of things. Right? So the title is a SQL to C compiler in 500 lines of code. And that's all I have. I'll be happy to take any questions. Thanks. Yes, please.
Yeah, so I'm still trying to wrap my head around this. But my question is there a correct definition? So if I forgot to chart one of them, does it produce correct results, or does it produce a correct
paradigm? So it depends. I mean, it's really leveraging the Scala type system, right? So if the types somehow don't match out, so if you say, okay, I marked this as dynamic, and then later you would assume that it's actually some static data, right? So you're passing it to a function that extracts a static value, then what you will get is a type error normally. And sort of a lot of the style of development boils down to, fixing sort of stage mismatches, right? Figuring out, okay, what is dynamic, what is static, and then making sure that those things all match up.
Okay, so I guess my question is, what it does not match up, is it a bonus issue, or is it a correct issue?
So most of the time it just won't compile. And of course there are sort of some things you can, sometimes you're delaying too many things, right? And then you don't get the performance benefits that you would like. Yes?
I was wondering if this ARP scale optimization for upstream or is it a research project?
So it's a research project right now. So we have our own backend for Spark that generates native C code. So you can plug that in as an accelerator, and then for Spark SQL and data frame operations, you will get some speedups. But we're mostly targeting scale up on large machines, right? So we're not so much focused on cluster execution across many machines, but more like, okay, big memory, sort of large machines with many cores and terabytes of memory and so on. Yes. So we have not really looked at HDFS in particular, but sort of for normal file systems we do memory mapping and these kind of things. Yeah, we do have specialized file readers for Apache Parquet and such kind of things.
So you compared to MySQL. I mentioned this talk to my student who said, what, you mean Oracle doesn't already do JIT? So if you compare to a commercial database system, do they have this or not?
They're basically the same as MySQL or Postgres, yeah. There are...
If I go back and tell my student, they'll say they're appalled. So this is, given that you can do it in 500 lines of code, why build the commercial database companies because it's in their entire business? Mm-hmm.
So I think all database companies have some projects on query compilation, because it has become sort of one of the compute performance has become one of the bottlenecks, right? So traditional, the bottlenecks in databases were all related to I/O, right? But that has changed since most of the data today is actually in memory, right? And you're no longer needing to go to disk to read all the data. And so Oracle has projects on just-in-time compilation for databases. There's some systems are even commercially available. So I think SAP HANA, they have some code generation, and other companies. Microsoft Hackathon is another project.
And those presumably have the same performance as we do.
I don't know. I would think that we're a little faster. So what I showed here, I mean, we get the same performance as sort of the best research database systems, right? And I would assume that those are sort of a bit more cutting edge than what you can buy commercially. More questions? I'm sorry, say again.
Are you using the latest MacBook for the demo 1 gigabyte reading in 1 second?
Yes. I could also use my old one, it doesn't really matter. But
well, the numbers move 1 second.
Yeah, sure, but I mean, you get 3 seconds or something. So the relative difference stays the same, right? Yes?
You showed us the various runs against SQLite, you show us how many SQLite you have, because when it's not the script play file, but a lot of things play like not a side of buffers or the DMS flow game, what kind of framework, the next level of the parental isolation pipeline, etc. So is it pretty nice that?
Well, depends how you look at it, right? So it's not really apples to apples in that sense that we're doing more work than MySQL in some sense, right? So we're actually loading stuff from a file, versus MySQL is free to store the data directly in memory in some format that makes sense for them, right? So in one sense, we're even giving MySQL an unfair advantage here by just looking at the query time. And we're loading stuff from a CSV file, right? So we have all the parsing overhead and we need to traverse the whole file, right? So MySQL could potentially store things in columnar order and then would only have to traverse a fraction of the data.
Yeah, but you're not instructing it, so.
We're not instructing it, no, but yes.
You're essentially comparing the well-designed workload that work nicely with conventional file traversal and CSV parsing left apart against something that would actually, against general purpose database that requires
Sure, but I mean, so if you really want to do a proper job, right, then in the database system you would create indexes and so on, right? But sort of we could optimize the indexes in the same way, right? So it's just sort of a matter, okay, what kind of functionality do you assume, right? In our case, we really want to compare like the raw scan performance and sort of see, okay, what kind of overheads are internal to these systems. And if you're looking at index performance, then, well, that's a different thing to do.
So it's not only about it, because like, you show us just the overall runtime, but you do show us, for instance, the breakdown, how much each of those processes spends doing I/O and how much it spends on CPU. And like, it might be that MySQL just spends all the time logging or doing something that is completely unrelated to either query optimization or I/O.
That's certainly possible, right? But sort of, yeah, I mean, the question is, well, what tool should you use if you want to, run this kind of query on a file like this, right? You can look at very different scenarios, right? But I mean, in any case, this is just sort of one little demo, right? So I think the more interesting comparisons are actually things like TPCH and sort of standard benchmarks, right? And they are sort of, I think those are much more interesting in terms of comparison and results. Yes.
And also, you said there is a recent reporting about integrating with Apache Spark. Apache Spark, so remember, Apache Spark is a magical site for their SQL engine. it doesn't mean that you are doing a new plane with lightness approach to a logical cycle.
So what we do with Spark is essentially, so this is the regular Spark architecture, right, if you want. So they can program using data frames or actual SQL statements. And what we do is sort of we're bypassing the lower level RDD layers and these kind of things, right? So we're just extracting the query plans from Catalyst, and then we're using our own code generation here. I thought if you talk about, okay, well, what might MySQL do internally with locking and so on, right? So Spark doesn't do any kind of locking, right? Because it's purely analytical. Right? And sort of the fact that Spark and Postgres here have very similar performance characteristics, I think that sort of captures kind of where the inefficiencies are in those systems.
We got to let the next person start getting set up. Thank you.
Sounds good. Thanks.